Thank you very much, dear Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to discuss with you during the next 10 minutes the topic on cryptogenic stroke with PFO, whether we are ready to close. And I'm here just to tell you and give you some arguments that we are ready to close. So this is my disclosure statement, and then you will realize that I don't have any financial interest as it relates to this topic. Apart from my home institution, I'm coming from Bern and the home institution of Bernhard Meyer, and I'm an interventional cardiologist. So PFO and stroke, I will guide you through this topic by asking the question whether it's an association by chance or a cause-effect relationship. And I will just tackle on the criteria by Bradford Hill to provide epidemiological evidence of a causal relationship between a presumed cause and an observed effect. And I will tackle on the following issues. First of all, on the strength of the association and the consistency of findings. Second, the biologic plausibility. Third, the temporal sequence and the risk of recurrence. And fourth, the biological gradient or dose-response relationship. First of all, strength and consistency. This is a very old study showing the prevalence of PFO in very young patients, patients below the age of 55. And in this meta-analysis, there was a clear positive association on cryptogenic stroke when compared to patients with known cause of stroke for the association of PFO and cryptogenic stroke. Second, some of you might have been familiar already with such images. So the biological plausibility with the proof of paradoxical embolism is given with this image. The risk of recurrence, already a study from 2001 on almost 600 patients, mean age 42 years of age, and then you might realize that patients with specific anatomical features, in that case a PFO and atrial septal aneurysm, they are prone to recurrent cryptogenic stroke or recurrent stroke. But the biological gradient, we know from the literature that PFO and the anatomical size in millimeter is a predictive stroke, the physiological size here in microbubbles, and the functional size with a spontaneous shunt from right to left. All of this is just theoretic and just summarizing the early literature. And coming then into the clinical trial setting, some might realize or visualize that there is a clear association between the PFO and cryptogenic stroke. And the question whether it's an incidental bystander or culprit region was addressed in the systematic assessment of 23 case control studies. And there you might realize that particularly patients, young patients, with certain high risk features are prone, that the probability of the PFO is incidental and the rate is very low. So in randomized trials, you might be familiar with the early trials with Closure 1, PC trial, and Respect trial. All of those three trials, they were inconclusive. Inconclusive meaning that no significant statistical significance was found during the observational period of almost 7 years. But you might realize that the curves in this Kaplan-Meier graph, they are diverging. And this was the open field for meta-analysis. And some groups did a different approach. So what we did is we did a network meta-analysis, including almost 9,300 patient years. And then you might see that there's a potential that probably the device is probably the cause or might be one of the causes that those trials were not conclusive. And you will see here differences in devices for stroke and for atrial fibrillation. Another group was recently published, just focused on antithrombotic or antiplatelet therapy. And here only the summary estimate is positive. The point estimates are well on the left side, but only the summary estimate favors PFO closure in this meta-analysis. So what we already know from a non-valvular atrial fibrillation is that warfarin or oral anticoagulation is superior to antiplatelet therapy. And just recording that the medical therapy in the major trials was left to the discretion of the operator, and patients under oral anticoagulation were found in only one-third of these patient populations, you might realize that antiplatelet therapy could be a factor, but is not the appropriate therapy for stroke prevention. Particularly as vitamin K antagonists have a narrow therapeutic window as shown on the left side, and on the right side, the suboptimal INR control is one of the major things why medical treatment is probably not ideal in some of our patients. Here, the treatment discontinuation, you already saw this data by Ulf Landmesser, and you will see that one-fifth to one-third of patients need to discontinue their treatment, NOAC and oral anticoagulation in randomized clinical trials. That this also holds true in the real world is shown in this cohort study from the UK. And there you also see the same rate of patients with non-valvular atrial fibrillation that are not prone to oral anticoagulation during a follow-up. So patient selection is key in PFO closure. And the risk of paradoxical embolism study created a dedicated calculator just focusing on clinical characteristics that might be associated with a culprit lesion in the PFO, and the PFO attributable fraction up to 88% when patients met a ROPE score of 9 to 10. That it's not only the clinical characteristics that make a PFO a culprit lesion has been shown also in the DEFENCE PFO trial. Here, the investigators focused just on PFO high-risk features, such as PFO size more than equal than 3 millimeter, presence of atrial septal aneurysm, the hypomobility of the septum during Valsalva, or exaggerated motion of the atrial septum during Valsalva, either with a septal excursion of more than 10 millimeter or a large PFO size. So when respecting all those features together, you don't need that many patients. Here, 120 patients, mean age as we are used to have this in the PFO patient population of 50 years of age, and randomization one by one. And then you might realize that there was no endpoint met in the PFO closure group with the Amplatzer PFO occluder. Periprocedural risk of percutaneous PFO closure is a certain argument why you should not go under, why you should not go undergo this intervention. But here, this data that have been recently published last week show that in this patient cohort, atrial fibrillation, esophageal hematoma, deep venous thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, these are the only events that have been found in 201 patients. None of the devices embolized, there was no thrombosis and cardiac tamponade, and also no major vascular complication was found in this study. Furthermore, long-term clinical outcomes are presented here, and then you might see that those are very limited. This is a median follow-up duration of 12 years, up to 17 years patients have been followed up to 17 years, and you will see that particularly patients that are not prone to anticoagulation or cannot receive any anticoagulation or any antiplatelet therapy, they do well. This is only a very limited number of patients with 42, but you will see, you don't see any stroke, TIA, or thrombosis, or thrombosis-related events during a follow-up of 12 years in these patients. So, when coming to the argument of cost-effectiveness, then this recent analysis just showed the cost-effectiveness threshold when combining five RCTs and more than 3,400 patients up to a mean follow-up duration of 4 years. And then you will see that the cost-effectiveness threshold is met after 2.7 years from closure. So most frequently, the BMJ provided some rapid recommendations for PFO closure versus antiplatelet therapy with a strong recommendation for percutaneous PFO closure. However, we need to be careful because there is an increase in atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, and they point to the fact that the increase in device-related adverse events. Furthermore, PFO closure versus anticoagulants, there's a weak, but there is a recommendation also here, decrease in major bleeding in favor of the PFO closure. However, also increase in atrial fibrillation and device-related adverse events. With the summary of the European position paper that has been issued 2 weeks back, I would like to conclude that percutaneous closure of a PFO should be performed in carefully selected patients aged under the age of 55, as it is in our as it has been performed in the trials. Patients with a confirmed cryptogenic stroke, TIA or systemic embolism, and an estimated high probability of a causal role of the PFO as assessed by clinical, anatomical, and imaging features. PFO closure must be proposed to each patient, evaluating their individual benefit based on the assessment of both the role of the PFO in the thromboembolic event and the expected results and risk in a lifelong medical therapy. PFO closure can also be considered in patients more than 65 years of age or less than 18 years of age, taking into account case-by-case basis the lack of evidence, the age-related confounders, and additional risks of interventional and drug therapies. And we need to consider that the choice of the device, here we need to reflect upon the literature that has been performed with these devices, and we need to see that the amplets are the Gore Helix septal-occluder that is not available anymore, and the Gore cardioform septal-occluders are well studied in the literature. Thank you very much.